Doctor Who. Earthshock. Written by Ian Marter. Read by Peter Davison. Chapter 1. Shadows. The towering cliffside resembled a gigantic human skull, with the dark openings of caves gaping like empty eye sockets and nostrils. High overhead, the sun cast deep, ominous shadows over the wild precipice, and huge birds of prey wheeled silently in the hot, dry air. At the bottom of the wall of rock yawned a cavernous mouth overhung with bristling thorn bushes and dangerously loose scree. 10 tall, lean figures were positioned in a menacing arc around the cave entrance, their young faces alert but impassive. They all wore tight-fitting green uniforms consisting of a kind of battle-dress tunic, trousers tucked into boots, a protective helmet and gloves. They stood, motionless, levelling sleek, tubular weapons into the darkness. Behind them, other uniformed figures were huddled round a quietly humming machine, resembling a small radar apparatus. They were staring intently at the greenish glow of a display screen which was protected by a hooded visor from the glaring sunlight. A pair of dish-shaped antennae connected to the machine were scanning slowly back and forth along the base of the cliff. Nearby, a rather plain, plumpish woman in her late 30s and dressed in tattered buff overalls and a white mining helmet was pacing agitatedly up and down, her hands twisting the ragged remains of a pair of gloves. She darted anxious glances repeatedly at the sky, at the cave, and at the frowning faces round the scanner. After a long silence, the young trooper seated at the control console turned to the tall, dark-haired officer standing beside him. "It's hopeless, Lieutenant Scott. There's nothing, absolutely nothing," he reported, gesturing at the blank screen. Lieutenant Scott glanced helplessly across at the endlessly pacing woman and fingered his moustache. Then he walked slowly over to her. "I'm sorry, Professor Kyle, there's no sign of them," he murmured. The young woman bit her lip as she struggled to remain composed. She was blinking back the tears behind the sunglasses. "Well, could they be shielded from your apparatus in some way?" she asked desperately, stopping and spreading her arms vaguely. Scott shook his head. "Only by lead or alloy screen," he replied. "The scanner detects and focuses on the body's cardio-neurological activity. It's specifically tuned to mammalian life. It's extremely reliable." Professor Kyle looked up at the slowly circling vultures. "I just can't believe that they're all dead," she said in a hollow voice. "It seems such a senseless waste." Scott nodded. Then he turned briskly. "Trooper Walters, make one final scan. Maximum amplification," he ordered. He put his hand gently on the professor's shoulder. "Rest assured that we shall catch whoever is responsible for this outrage, Professor Kyle," he added quietly, as the scanner whirred into action again. "They can't be far away," the professor replied bitterly. "I radioed as soon as I got out of the main cavern." "And we came as fast as we could," Scott said abruptly, his pale eyes searching the woman's dark lenses as if he were seeking some loophole in her story. He looked at her ashen face, streaked with dirt and a little dried blood. "How many of you were there down there?" he suddenly demanded.
8, including myself," she answered in a startled voice.
"And what were you doing, exactly?"
A survey, I told you," the professor stammered, glancing nervously at the slowly tracking antennae. "The inner cave system has only recently been discovered, and it's unusually rich in fossils. Some of them are hitherto unknown species and..."
"Palaeontologists," Scott interrupted.
"And geophysicists," Miss Kyle nodded. "The area is geologically rather unstable, and we..."
"It's also a security zone," Scott cut in harshly. "You have permits, of course." The professor took off her sunglasses. The pupils of her large brown eyes shrank in the sudden glare. "Of course, Lieutenant," she retorted, trying to meet his hard stare without flinching.
"It doesn't make sense," Scott exclaimed, turning on his heel and walking back over to the scanner. After a few minutes, Trooper Walters switched off and stood up.
"Scan completed, sir. Negative. There's no sign of life."
Scott contemplated the blank screen for a moment, fiddling uneasily with the ends of his moustache. He became aware that Professor Kyle was staring at him with a new determination in her pale face. He turned authoritatively to the efficient-looking young female officer beside him. "Sergeant Mitchell, prepare the squad. We're going in," he snapped. The troopers checked their radios and switched on the twin lamps fitted on either side of their helmets. Within a few seconds, the well-disciplined task force was ready to enter the caves. Scott had drawn Mitchell aside. "What do you think of Kyle's story?" he asked her. She glanced across at the professor. "I think it's the truth, sir, at least as far as she knows it." Scott grunted. "We'll keep her up front where we can see her, just in case," he murmured. Then went over to Kyle. "I am sorry to drag you down there again after what you've been through," he said. Professor Kyle shrugged. "You'd never find the bodies without my guidance," he replied, managing a brave smile. "The inner cave system is completely uncharted." Scott nodded curtly. He beckoned a squat, tough-looking female trooper standing by the scanner. "Snyder, you remain here with Walters," he ordered. "I want a constant scan. Inform me the instant you detect anything." With a jerk of the head, Scott motioned Professor Kyle to lead the way, and he and his squad followed her into the darkness. At first, they made rapid progress through the outer tunnels of the labyrinth, which twisted and turned as it bored deeper and deeper into the mountain. Subsidiary tunnels branched continually in every direction, and at regular intervals, Scott halted the squad, and their sharp twin beams stabbed into the hollow blackness, revealing shiny, snake-like strata and weird gargoyle formations in the rock. Faint marker lamps had been installed in the main tunnel by the professor's survey team, and as the troopers jogged along, their shadows coiled and flapped around them on the uneven walls like long-forgotten ghosts. Not far away, in the waiting darkness, two other shadowy forms, without any light or human bodies to project them, suddenly detached themselves from the cold, damp gloom and flitted silently along, keeping watch and biding their time. It was as if the darkness had formed itself into two humanoid shapes, tall and slim, male and female, hairless and featureless, with heads like huge, polished black stones. Live and powerful, they effortlessly stalked the 13 struggling humans through the echoing maze, keeping always just out of reach of the probing helmet lamps. When the task force paused, they also paused. Their enormous heads poised as if listening, and no sound of breathing disturbed the dank air around them. And when they moved on again, they moved together as one being, as if knowing each other's very thoughts. These black beings were the sentinels of the mountain and the vigilant guardians of the secret at its very heart. Out in the blinding sunlight, Trooper Snyder was squinting into the visor and following the dogged progress of the 13 fluorescent dots moving in close formation across the scanner screen. Trooper Walters was leaning against the hood, swigging water from a flask and craning up at the ominous bird still hanging high above them. Suddenly, Snyder leaned closer and put her arms around the edge of the visor to shut out more of the glare. "Is that supposed to happen?" she exclaimed. "What?" Walter said, trying to peer over her shoulder. "It's gone now. There was a kind of flaring just there," Snyder explained, indicating a place on the screen close to the slowly moving pinpoints representing Scott and his squad. Walters thumped the side of the console. "Probably ghosting," he muttered scornfully. "This contraption's ancient." "But the lieutenant said it was..." Snyder broke off, and they both stared wide-eyed at a blurred, luminous patch which had suddenly appeared next to the group of moving blips. "There it is again," Snyder cried. "I think we should warn them." Walters leaned over and adjusted some of the controls. The strange patch grew momentarily brighter and then faded to nothing again. He shook his head. "Just tetramagnetic echo," he grunted. "There's nothing there." He took another greedy swig at the flask. Snyder wiped the sweat out of her eyes and shaded the scanner with her arms again. "Well, I don't like it," she murmured, peering into the visor. "I believe in ghosts." Adric lay on his bunk, staring up at the ceiling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.